Welcome back, everybody. I always get excited hearing that theme music because that means we're about to get a great new episode with some awesome, inspiring stories. Today is no different. And I know that a lot of you probably have had at least some sort of contact with law enforcement, right? Positive or negative, depending on whether you got arrested or not. But I wanted to really sit down with someone who's been out there in the field, in the streets, experienced a lot of different things. And so today we have Ray Madrigal. Welcome, Ray.
Thank you. Thank you. Appreciate it.
And we're going to talk a little bit about all of your history, and you've done many things, but the one thing that kind of stood out to me was California Highway Patrol. And I believe, is it 30 years?
That's right. Yes, I started in 1980. I went to the CHP Academy in West Sacramento, and I retired in 2010.
Wow. And so I can't even imagine. We'll try to get as many stories as possible, but we do want to come up with some important points that affect our listeners and viewers. So I want to start from the beginning, okay. Right? So just to give you guys a little background, because some people ask me, okay, Rob, where do you and Jim find your guests, right? And so everyone's a different story, but it's usually someone thing that connects to other things we do in life. And for you, I remember the first time I met you, I was at an event for the King's Lions Club. Mm-hmm. Shout out to the King's Lions in Lemoore, yes. Doing a lot of great work for the Kings County area. And I had met you guys there because I was invited to a Lions Club meeting.
Mm-hmm.
And I can't remember what office you held at the time. But
were you president
at one point?
No, that's my brother-in-law, Ray Etchegoyen. That's probably who you're thinking.
Yeah, yeah. So I remember Ray because Ray's from Stratford, and he's married to your sister, Peeny. Yes. By the way, thank you, Peeny Etchegoyen, for all the great stories that you shared to prepare me for this. But yeah, I know that you were at a meeting and you were present. And you're very active in the community. And so that's how we first met. And then in speaking with you, or at least in some sort of conversation, I find that you were also served as the mayor of Lemoore.
That's correct.
So we want to cover that too.
Absolutely.
And I was like, man, this guy's so involved. And then I found out that you were CHP. After when I met you, you had already retired. This was 2014, 2015. But I said, man, if I ever get something together, I want to have Ray on the show because I know he's got a lot to offer and to share about his experiences in life.
Thank you. Long time coming, I guess.
Yeah,
I know we've been talking about doing this for a while and just didn't work out with our scheduling and everything, but I'm really happy to be here.
And and I'm so glad you're here. So we're going to start from the beginning.
Okay.
Born and raised in Lemoore area, Kings County?
We were. I have four sisters and a brother.
Yeah.
Mom and dad, we were all born in Stockton,
okay,
California.
So Northern California.
Northern California, up in the Delta. Lived in a little town called Isleton.
Wow. Every time I go by there, I learn a new town. Harold, Galt.
Yes, exactly.
Elk Grove.
All those little towns up there. So we were in Isleton. My dad's family was there. They worked in the canneries up there.
Okay. Like Del Monte or?
Del Monte, you name it. Yeah, they all worked. All of my dad's family, he had a large family. And my mom and dad got married. My mom's from Mexico. My dad was born here.
Okay.
But anyway, after we were, little kids, I think we came to Lemoore in 1960. I was about 2 years old then. And we settled there in Lemoore, and we've been there ever since.
Okay. So, for those who don't know, and I think I've mentioned this before, I'm based out of Lemoore, California. We've got a naval base down about 5-6 miles down the street where they, for those viewers who watch Top Gun, right? The latest Top Gun was filmed there. And I like the mix that we have in Lemoore because you have the military families, you have the Lemoore locals, mm-hmm. You have a lot of farmers, mm-hmm. Farm laborers, all kind of combined in one area.
Mm-hmm.
And so I love the mix that we have in that community. Hanford, not as much military presence because a little bit further, but still the same kind of combination of populations. And I really enjoy that. So I've been there since 2014, about 10 years now. You've been there since you were 2 years old.
Yep.
Has Lemoore changed a lot?
Oh, it's changed tremendously. I always tell people, my kids, I tell them when we were growing up, Lemoore was maybe 6,000 population or so. And it didn't go much further than, right there where the Starbucks is now. That area was kind of like the edge of town on the north side. It was really fun. I mean, just growing up in that environment, Leave It to Beaver type of neighborhood.
Yeah, you said 6,000 at the time?
About 6,000.
So our population now is between 25 and 30,000, right?
Yes, yeah. It's changed a lot. And like you said, a lot of it has to do with the military. Mm-hmm. I grew up with a lot of military kids in school.
Yeah.
You know, they'd come and go throughout the years. But I always tell people, an example of what makes Lemoore so great is you notice that a lot of the people, after they retire from the Navy, they stay there.
That is a good sign. Yeah,
really good place for families, raise your children. And so that's, I think it's a selling point for the city of Lemoore.
Yeah, they could stick around.
Yes.
So went to elementary school there in Lemoore. What was it, Lemoore Elementary, or where were you at?
I went to Lemoore Elementary, right there on Bush Street.
Yeah.
It was
Lemoore Lions.
Walking distance from my house, my parents' house on Linda Lane. All of us would walk to school there. So one through, let's see, first grade through fifth grade, went there. And then I was in the group of kids, the first group of kids to ever attend P.W. Ingvall School. You know
okay,
where that
yes.
is now, right? Yes. It's actually an elementary school now, but it started out as a junior high school. So
I didn't know
sixth,
that.
Seventh, and eighth grade went there. So when I started my sixth grade year, I went to P.W. Ingvall as the first group of kids. And those houses that are across from it now, if you know Lemoore, that was nothing but an open field out there. And I remember my friends and I, we would go watch as they were, the school was being built over a year or so. And I recall a guy, an old man from, I think he was Basque, he was out there grazing sheep. And he had a sheepdog out there. So we'd go out there and talk to him and just kind of spend our, you know, that's the kind of thing that we did in Lemoore back then.
A lot of agriculture, right?
Yeah, absolutely. A lot of agriculture, a lot of, you know, I always tell people it's the breadbasket of the world, literally. You know, if you think about how much, how many products and crops and things that are grown in and around that area, you got the dairies. I mean, it's just really important. That's why, you know, water has been such an important thing.
Yeah.
One of the things that I'm always interested in is where our water's, how it's getting there and what we're doing to store water and provide water for agriculture.
Yeah. Well, here's the other thing about living in small towns like that. And Jim, back me up on this, because Jim's from a small town as well. Cutler, mm-hmm. You know Cutler, right?
I actually patrolled up there.
Oh, there you go.
One of my areas
chased
of patrol.
Chased you down, Jim, when you were a kid.
No, I was never arrested.
You that got away from
I was
me.
Never arrested.
So, okay, so we're all from small towns, right?
Yeah.
And so I had this theory that, like, your chances of getting involved in some sort of sport go way up when you come from a town where there's not a whole lot to do.
Yep.
Because even the kids who are maybe not into sports are like, well, what else am I going to do right now?
Absolutely.
Okay, you're kickball, baseball, whatever it was, right? And I really loved that component. What role did sports play for you growing up in small towns?
A lot. I can't think of a time when I wasn't out there throwing a ball around or, you know, just chasing the ball around with the kids, playing out in the schoolyard. We'd play wiffle ball all the time. I don't know if you've ever played wiffle ball.
With the yellow bat.
Yeah, we would spend time out in the front yard. We had this one game we called beer can ball. So my friend and I, we'd smash an aluminum beer can, and that would be the ball that we'd throw at each other and hit it with a wooden, like a broom handle or something. But ever since that, I mean, I probably got into every single sport there was. And it really helped me, I think, just be part of the, think about being part of a team and growing up and how, you know, you see your coaches and what role models they can play and things like that was kind of one of the things that really inspired me later on to just try to help our community. Because I felt like sports was one of the ways that I got into, you know, your friends, you made friends that way. You got accepted at school, all that kind of thing. So yeah, it was sports. I can't tell you a time when I wasn't playing sports when I was a little kid.
I think it's a great thing too that you played multiple sports because I said this with our earlier guest. We had a guest named Ernie Rodriguez who also used sports as a way to meet and connect with people. That when you play different sports, you're not always at the same level with each sport. Let's say that you're a natural baseball player, but now we've got you playing basketball or soccer, right?
Mm-hmm.
A little different. in terms of the skill set. And it kind of teaches you that humility that, like, hey, I don't have to be great at everything to play it and enjoy it.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, I don't have to dominate the whole playground to still have a good time.
That's pretty much the way it was with me. Actually, I ended up being probably my favorite sport, or the best sport, I guess I was baseball. I was a fairly good baseball player back in the day. Had some success. I played on the team 1977, our high school baseball team, was second in the valley that year, in the whole valley. And that was at a time when they didn't have divisions.
You played all the big schools.
We played the big schools. We played the little schools. Friday night, we played Dos Palos High School from the semifinals.
Oh, wow.
And then the very next night, we played Bullard High School in the finals. So that's the big disparity as far as it was. And, I mean, that's just the way it happened. And so anyway, what my point was going to be was baseball was the game that I was probably most successful at. But my favorite sport was basketball.
Oh, okay.
But as you can see, I'm a little vertically challenged. So,
are you about 5'9", 5'10"?
Yeah, that's what I tell people, 5'8".
5'8",
I think I'm shrinking over the years. But, you know, I was pretty good at that game, too. And then we start into high school, and my friends start having that growth spurt.
Yeah.
You know, right about the freshman, sophomore
year. Yeah, some of us stay.
They start growing, and I kind of reach my max. So basketball wasn't in my future, but I sure loved playing out there on the schoolyard at MIQ school. We used to play there just day after day out there. So
yeah, it's kind of interesting that a lot of times we don't necessarily pursue the one that is our favorite. We kind of go with, okay, what best meets our tool set or
yep.
And for baseball, you can be fairly.
You don't need to be big.
Yeah, you don't have to be big.
A good baseball player.
Football, basketball, a little different.
Yeah.
Jim, what was your favorite growing up? I know you played all of them.
So mine was basketball.
Yeah. Oh, it was?
Yeah. So my favorite sport was
basketball. See, I assumed football this whole time. Because you were really good at football, so I figured that was your thing.
So, which is funny because I'm tall. I'm 6'4". Everyone's like, oh, you could dunk it. And I couldn't dunk. White boy can't dunk.
And, did you get close?
I was close. I was really close. And I remember one time we had a kid because I grew up in Rosie and Cutler.
Rosie Cardinals.
Yep. And we had those a few tall guys.
Yeah.
Growing up, that were Hispanic and stuff. There was only a few white people in our whole school. But
five of you guys.
We had a kid, Daryl Mills.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He
came over to our school. And he was African American, and he joined the basketball team. And everyone was like, "Dude, we got someone that could dunk." And we never even seen him play. And the
assumptions.
The boy couldn't dunk. He could not dunk at all. So it was the stereotype that was it let us down.
Really?
Oh well. Hey.
But then he went to Dinuba, so and he did well over there.
He played football for us.
Yeah.
So. And we made no assumptions about you. But, we love you, Daryl.
But it was funny what he said is my favorite sport was basketball. But I was really good at football.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I remember that.
And okay. I didn't like baseball too much because someone throwing a ball at me 90 miles an hour.
Yeah, that's not easy when someone's throwing a rock at you.
Yeah. So,
like that.
No, never did it.
They sting when they hit you.
Now, your coach is not just any coach. He had the baseball field named after him, correct?
Yeah.
That's Bob Clement.
Bob Clement, Coach Clement, still a good friend of mine, lives down the street from me.
Oh, okay. Does
he? Yeah, we see each other pretty regular.
See, that's pretty cool because, you know, you have a lot of coaches throughout your high school career and especially play multiple sports, and rarely do you have somebody who's that well, has left such a legacy that they've got the field named after him.
Yep. Yeah, absolutely.
And you got to play for him.
He did a lot. I remember when I started there, I played Babe Ruth there. I mean, it's at the age of 13 at Lemoore High School.
Yeah.
The varsity field, and that thing was not in good shape at all. And then when he came in, he really did a lot with the community. Got a lot of, outside people to come in and help. They built the dugouts and just.
He's an organizer, right?
He is. I think I told you that before we went on the air. He was very organized, very community oriented. He used to actually organize every year during the baseball season. He would do a baseball trip where every player on the team would be able to go. We took a bus trip. It was a Saturday, and we would have to sell like these coupons for different businesses around. We'd have to sell 10 of these coupons.
That was a fundraiser?
Yeah, that was our fundraiser in order to earn our way on the trip. So we would go watch a baseball game, and then we'd go to a theme park in the evening.
Wow.
All in one day. So we went to see the A's. We went to see the Angels. We went to see the Dodgers and the Giants in my 4 years.
All four
we
teams.
We went to Disneyland. We went to Magic Mountain.
Great America.
It was really neat. I mean, we looked forward to it. And I look back at, and I've talked to him about this. I go, that's a big deal having responsibility for all those kids. And he tells me, you know what? That's what the administration always thought about it. But he was able to do it well. He had, you know, chaperones and stuff. And no major incidents. I'm not going to say there weren't any
yeah.
incidents.
Yeah.
But nothing major. Really major. Yeah. So
that is a really cool.
That just okay. goes to show how one person can make an impact on yeah. the community.
And that's funny. That's how I met him, was he was making an impact on the community. He was the president of the Kiwanis Club in mm-hmm. Lemoore.
Yep.
And we were a new nonprofit reestablishing Stratford, and we were looking for assistance.
Mm-hmm.
And the Kiwanis helped us out. And he was, I yeah. remember he was the first guy I met, Bob. Yep.
Do you know that he went on to become the athletic director at West Hills College?
I didn't know that.
Yeah,
no.
After he left Lemoore High School, I think he coached Lemoore High School for 20-some years, 27 if I'm not mistaken. Yeah. And then he went on to become the athletic director there at West Hills College to finish out his career. And he brought the big state tournament for soccer back in the day to Lemoore. This was, you know, I was off in my CHP world, probably down south. I wasn't around town, but he told me, he never played soccer in his life.
Yeah.
But somehow through the community college system, the sports system, he got connected with people that were into soccer, and he ended up organizing the state finals there, you know, at Lemoore Youth Soccer Complex.
Oh, there.
They'd
wow.
bring all the teams right there from all over the state.
Yeah.
And they'd have their soccer tournament. So
that's beautiful.
He actually, I think he, don't quote me on this, but I think he got inducted into some sort of soccer hall of fame for the state community college.
Really, and baseball, soccer and baseball.
I'm telling you, the guy, he's something else.
We're going to have to bring him in here.
That would be
Bob,
good.
We're looking for you. Rob
yes,
Live.
Yes.
Okay, so I want to talk a little bit about high school because there's some pretty good stories here. Okay, so okay. We talked about one earlier.
All right.
Okay, so everyone knows that back in the day, even still today, right, they typically will schedule dances after the football games, right? So, and back in the day, that was like a big thing to go to. Right now, I'm a high school teacher. I don't see the same sort of energy where like the whole school shows up, but there is a population that looks forward to the after game dance. And I know I did. And so I heard that you had a football game and you had your ankle broken by a future NFL player.
Mm-hmm.
And you still show up to the dance.
Hey.
That's dedication.
I wasn't going to miss that. And like I said, think about it. Showing up at a dance with a cast on your leg, you know, all the sympathy you're going to get yeah. from the girls and stuff.
Signing my
card. I didn't want to miss my chance. But so it's funny that my sister would remember that. But, yeah, so I was a junior in high school. JVs, playing JVs. We were playing against Mount Whitney High School, which was a powerhouse back then all the time. And somehow I was carrying the ball around the end, and I got drugged down from behind by a guy named Don Mosbar. He was much younger. He was a freshman at that time. I was on the JVs. But he went on to be a professional football player.
With the Oakland Raiders,
with the
right?
Oakland Raiders. I think he went to USC or something. But
wow.
even at that time, he was a force to be reckoned with in
Apparently.
The middle of the line, man. He was just blowing our guys off. You know, so anyway, so yeah, I break my leg during the game. They tape me up. Hey, walk it off. That was
the
deal.
I heard you went back in the game with a taped up broken ankle.
So I was the only guy that had practiced holding the point after touchdowns for the kick,
place,
the extra
placeholder.
So that's what I did. A good friend of mine, Tony Torres, I don't know if you know him or not. he's a famous baseball player from Lemoore. He went on to play professional baseball, but
Tony
he
Torres.
Was our kicker and my best friend still to this day. And so he would basically almost carry me out to do the point after.
It's got to be you, Ray.
I couldn't put any weight on it, but he'd get me out there. I'd hold it. He'd kick it through the uprights, and then he'd carry me back to the bench for the game.
And did it work? Were you guys successful with the extra points?
I think we won the game, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah.
Wow.
So that happened. That was an interesting one.
That's dedicated.
But there was also two other guys on the team that broke their leg that same day on our team.
Did they go back to the dance as well?
I don't remember about
it. It was like the handicap crew just coming
in.
I
don't remember if they did or not.
Party starts, Ray's here.
I do remember that all three of us were taken to the hospital after the game and got cast put on our leg at the same time.
And this was 70s, right?
That was probably around 1975, I guess.
Okay, so I was born in 73. I don't remember that much at that time, 2 years old. But I do remember, looking back at the 70s, it was like long hair was a very common thing.
Yeah.
Did you have your hair grown out?
I wanted to.
Oh, okay.
That was one of my dad and I. My dad was a real strict guy. He'd been in the military, and the long hair didn't go over with him. So I would push it as far as I could. And I look now, my mom still has all of our senior photos, you know, they're displayed at the house. And I look at myself, I go, man, my hair was long. I can't believe my dad let it get that long. I remember one time we'd been arguing about getting a haircut. Time to get a haircut. Time to get a haircut. And I put it off as long as I could. Finally, I go down to Richard's barbershop in Lemoore. It's still there, but Richard's long gone. His son, I think, runs it now. But so I go in there, I go, hey, Richard, just take a little bit off the bottom, you know. Well, apparently my dad had already called down there because I got out of that chair, man. I was like, oh,
hey, Richard, what happened?
I know. Come on,
your dad,
Richard,
called, okay?
I think my dad must have called down there and said, hey, give him a regular cut. I guess I had long hair. A lot of kids had a lot longer, but it was a style. It was a
bell-bottoms.
Bell-bottoms. Oh, you name it. We wear the bell-bottoms. And so I got to tell you something about the dances, though, something that's interesting. So I know now from what you tell me that, and kids, the high school dances aren't a big deal anymore.
No, Jim, how about Liberty? Because he works at a high school. Are they a big deal?
Yeah. I mean, yeah, they are, because it's what you said before. Our school's small, so there's nothing else to do out here. So if there's a Friday night dance or a Saturday night dance, we usually get over 100 kids, you know, for a school of 600-700 kids.
Well, that's
so
good.
So, yeah, I mean, it's fun. I think it depends on the theme, where it's located. Because, I mean, back in our day, it was the gym.
Yes,
the gym was it. You didn't even have
the high school gym.
You didn't have an option.
Nope.
Now, when I was I did activities for 9 years. So, so I was in charge of all of it. We had stuff outside. We had outside dances. Mm. In our high school days, we had float building. And that Wednesday before the Friday, we had a float building / dance at the same time. So I think if you get creative, you got to get the kids. And also it's revenue.
Yeah.
You know, I always like to charge at least $5, you know, have the kids come in and stuff. And then, so is it as popular anymore? I think back then it was, you know, now it's, we don't really do Friday dances that much because the kids sometimes will go home and shower. They don't shower at the schools anymore. You know, so I don't know. I mean,
that was a big deal for us. So what I was going to get to as far as the music, we had live band all the time.
What?
Live band.
Live band. And they would just cover popular songs?
Yeah. The band that came there most of the time was called Rainbow Bridge.
Okay.
And some of those members had played in a band with Steve Perry.
Steve Perry,
you know,
those that don't know.
Lemoore.
Okay, did you go to school with him?
He's a little older than me. No, I missed. He was actually Coach Clement's age.
Oh, okay.
In the mid-60s. So that their band, the remnants of his old band, were the ones that played at our high school dance.
So that must have been really good.
So, I mean, we didn't. At that time, I think he was just starting to become famous, but they were really good. They were really good, and we loved all the rock and roll, the 70s rock and roll. That's what I grew up on.
Yeah,
I still listen to
great music.
That's why it's popular. I mean, that's why it would have been fun. I would have loved to have done that. Because now if you got a DJ that sucks, you know, no one likes to go to dances.
Well, I heard the DJ at your school is pretty good, Jim.
Well, yeah, she was,
That was his daughter. His daughter was what was her DJ name?
Cool.
DJ Mac.
DJ Mac.
I just made that up. She hated it. But Anyone need a DJ out there, let me know.
Yeah, cool. DJ Mac is available. So here's what I want to ask you about. So you went to school where Steve Perry, who then went on to Journey fame.
Yes.
Later, and Journey was kind of rising, right? The late 70s. Mm-hmm. Do you recall people at school having any sort of reaction to that? Like, bro, this guy went to school here, and he's on TV now. He's on solid gold.
It was a point of pride for us. Absolutely. Whenever we'd go somewhere, you know, and people would ask you where you're from. And
Steve Perry's hometown.
Yeah. So, I mean, he lived down on the end of Cinnamon.
Oh, he lived in Lemoore.
His mother lived there.
Okay.
And I don't know if he actually ever lived in that house. I think he did back in the day. But whenever he would come to town, he would come. Everyone knew when he was in town because he'd be like in a limousine or something like that.
Oh, wow.
He'd be cruising back in the day when we used to cruise Maine. Hey, Steve Perry's in town.
Oh, did you ever see him?
I saw him around, but I never actually met him or anything. But of course, it was a point of pride for us. That's a big deal.
Lemoore's had a lot of big names.
Heck yeah. I mean, think about it. Tommy Smith, Olympic gold medalist in the 200 meter. I mean, we got Lorenzo Neal.
Tommy Smith, the one with had the black glove.
The
and
guy
that's
1968.
He was from Lemoore.
He was from Lemoore.
Oh.
Absolutely.
Do you know that, Jim? That famous picture?
1968. They're standing on the pedestal getting their gold medals for track and field. No. And he's standing up there with the black glove on his hand.
Oh, that's right. Okay.
That's Tommy
Smith.
He's
from Lemoore.
Oh, no way.
Yes.
It's funny you say Lorenzo Neal. I played football with him.
Yeah. Okay. So
you did?
Yeah. Charlie Jones, Lorenzo Neal, Gene those Smith.
Oh, when you had your All-Star game?
All-Star, with Andy. So
they all played at Fresno State afterwards.
Yeah, great guys.
So Lemoore guys. Wow.
Lemoore's got, it has, we've had our share.
We got Ray Madrigal.
Oh, come on.
Private investigator.
Well, maybe they'll get a statue of me out there
at
one
some
of these
point.
Days.
Yeah, we gotta let you retire first so we can honor you.
That's true. I'm still working.
Okay, so you go through high school, and then at some point after graduation, you decide, and I want to ask you about this decision that you're gonna go into the California Highway Patrol.
Okay,
how did you fall upon that career path?
So, I think the main inspiration for me was my dad. He was in the military, okay? And I used to see a lot of pictures of him. He was in the military police. And so that kind of, we grew up, I mean, that kind of, I know, environment, pretty strict.
Yeah.
You know, good man, but he was definitely strict on
us. Was your mom strict as well, or was there like the balance?
Yeah, there's a balance.
Go ask your mom.
Exactly.
Mom, what do you think dad's going to say?
Then mom would say, hey, wait till your dad comes home.
Talk to your dad. That's why I'm talking to you.
But so that kind of got me leaning in that direction. But the one thing that really stands out in my mind as far as why I went to the highway patrol, at some point during high school, I think maybe our junior year, they had a career fair.
Yeah.
And all these different people, you know, career professionals come and they talk to the kids about, you know, what they do. Well, there was a guy from the CHP office in Hanford who I got to work with later on. His name was Jimmy Gregg. He was the public affairs officer, and he was sharp looking guy in his uniform. He was probably about 6'4", 6'5". You know, good shape, always had his brass polished up, and man, he looked good. He came in and gave us a really good inspirational talk, and so I started. That was the first seed that was planted. And then later on, maybe, I don't know, a year later on or something, I'm driving along 198 over close to Armona, and I see Jimmy Gregg in his patrol car. He had some person stopped on the side of the road, and again, there he is looking good, and I think, man, I want to do that. And that's kind of
that
what
was it.
Got me going, you know? And I always wanted to do something that didn't seem like a job.
Yeah.
And it seemed like it was exciting.
Yeah.
And a way.
Like Chips. Remember Chips?
And Chips was just coming out. I'm not going to say that was my inspiration, but
it looked exciting to me.
I never rode a motorcycle on CHP. Okay. I never quite got that brave. But that was happening at that time. And I liked the fact that they had an academy where you had to stay there. It was almost like a military.
Yes.
Okay, we had to live there, and it's in West Sacramento.
How long was that whole process?
That was 27, 28 weeks up in West Sacramento.
Oh, that's a lot longer than I thought.
Yeah.
They were going to say 28 days.
No, it was weeks. About 28 weeks of training, and you live in dormitories with, you know, your guys there at the academy.
About four months, I think.
Yeah.
Did you know that, Jim? It's a full academy overnight experience.
You live there. You get out on Wednesday nights if you're good. If you don't have any gigs, I used to call it, like, you know, your shoes were shined properly, your bed was made. They'd come in and inspect your bed. It was just like the military. And then we had 8 hours of classroom too that we did. They had it's a state of the art facility if you ever have a chance to go there. But in
West Sacramento. Is it still there?
It's still there, right there.
And that's where they do all the training for California Highway Patrol.
They have the 2.5 mile high speed track. They have a little area that's kind of designed like a city block so we could practice our pursuits.
Can you do tours there? I'd love to tour that.
I'm sure they do. Yeah, absolutely. If you want to do that, maybe we can set something up.
Yeah.
They got the skid pan out there.
So you practice all that stuff.
All that stuff. The driving, then they got the range and everything. I mean, it was a very difficult experience, but it was also rewarding. And, you know, I enjoyed it. I enjoyed it, and it got me set up. I felt, you know, it prepared me for the rest of my career. It's a good starting point. But anyway, so, yeah, that's kind of what got me started was Jimmy Gregg.
Jimmy Gregg. And you're making a lot of career center teachers very happy right now, because every high school now, right, you have a career center, and the career center's person is trying so hard to come up with all these different opportunities to expose kids to different careers. And one of them is when they invite all these different people in. So career center people, keep going. It is working.
Hey, it works.
Absolutely. Ray's 30 years CHP, and it worked for him. So you guys keep putting those things together.
Absolutely. It's definitely worthwhile. Even if you don't necessarily go into that particular career, because I knew law enforcement was something I was going to do eventually.
Yeah.
But that particular agency was the one that I was drawn to because of meeting Jimmy Gregg.
Okay. So I want to do this part because I don't want to forget later. And Jim, I think you'll be with me on this one. We're going to pick his brain about traffic safety.
Okay.
You know, the do's and don'ts.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's never quite what the commercials tell you, right? You watch the commercial, and the commercial says, hey, Ray, make sure you put your seatbelt on, right? And then it kind of stops there. But I'm sure there's a lot more to it in terms of what you actually see in terms of accidents, how people are driving, maybe some habits that we kind of overlook. Here's one that I think that doesn't get spoken about enough. And Jim, I don't know if you agree with me on this one, but the eating. See, drivers, right? When we're eating, a lot of times you're going to spill something.
Mm-hmm.
Now, because I've been having to drive long distances for so long, I always went to schools that were at least 3-4 hours from home. So I'm always driving along. I learned this. Jim, I don't know if you know this one. You got to tell your kids. If you're eating something and it falls, or you're drinking something, it falls, so be it.
Yeah.
It's done. You keep going. You don't look down. You don't react. You don't take your eyes. I have a friend who had an incident where they dropped the food, looked down, fixated on that, only for a second or two, and right, the car is now damaged. Luckily, nobody was harmed.
Yeah, absolutely. It's distracted driving.
Yeah, just so like food, cell phones it doesn't now come up that much, but food is a big one, right?
Actually, I don't recall anything involving food, but I recall a woman that was putting her makeup on while she was driving.
Oh, I know someone
that had an accident.
Yeah.
So this is a good story, good CHP story. Back in the day when I was working in Southern California on the San Diego Freeway, working day shift, and I mean, obviously, there's 5 or 6 lanes of traffic, stop and go. So somehow I see this woman, one of the lanes next to me, she's putting her makeup on. So I look at her, I pull her over, and I talk to her about distracted driving. You know, you really should be watching what you're doing instead of, oh, yeah, yeah. So I gave her a warning. I didn't write her a ticket. About, I get off the freeway. I don't even know. I went off. She kept on going. About 10 minutes later, here comes an accident. And guess who was involved?
Oh,
rear-ender.
No.
Same lady.
Same
Luckily, it was a slow speed bumper, not a bad deal.
Yeah.
But same lady had gotten it.
I'm like, and what did she? What did she think?
Her eyes were about as big as saucers when she saw me respond. She goes, "Oh, I go, yeah, remember me? I just told you about this."
Wow.
I have a question. I had a dispute with my family the other day in a car because the dome light, the light that's inside the car.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Back in the day, my dad would always yell at us because we're like, "Turn on the light. We need to get something in the back." And he would always say, like, "I only have so long. I got to turn this off." And my wife and I were in the car with the kids, and they were like, said to turn on the light. And I go, "We got to turn it off. You know, it's been driving for like 3 minutes with the light on. Is that legal now?" Because they were like, "We're going to get on Google and prove you wrong."
I will be honest with you. I've heard that, but I don't personally know of a vehicle code violation that would prohibit you from driving with the dome light on. I don't know that.
Give me one of these.
You might have to Google
it. I don't like that. Cause I was
now,
you may have to Google it.
Because it's bright in there and outside's light.
I could see
dark.
Where it would be a distraction to your vision.
And I'm like, I can't see.
Absolutely.
Oh, don't even get me started on pulling.
Maybe
this.
It's just an old wife's tale that started along the way.
I've heard it. I've heard it, too.
I've heard it, but I don't remember. I've never written a ticket for that, so that doesn't mean that
I'm still
doesn't exist.
hold that to. I don't like the lights on, so I want them off.
Okay, so I will tell you why that came up for me, Jim. Do you remember? Yeah, I'm sure you guys remember this. I want to say it was the 90s. There were snipers. They were shooting at people on the freeway. Mm-hmm. So if it's nighttime and I've got my dome light on, guess what I am?
Yeah, a target.
Now that's an extreme case, right?
Wow, you're like. But in Fresno, they were doing that, or was it in back east? It was in DC.
I thought Los
it?
Angeles oh, and maybe DC. Yeah, Los Angeles freeway, I know for sure.
Yeah,
and then back east as well. But it became a thing for a minute there.
Yeah,
and that's when I was like, okay, this dome light's staying it's off.
A sitting duck.
Yeah, but that it was never. But I thought it was a law as well. So
we'll have to find out about.
Yeah,
that.
We're gonna look that one up about that to one. Be continued.
Yes.
So you go through the academy. Mm-hmm. And this is another story your sister shared that I'm going to bring up. You're now in patrol and you're by yourself. Mm-hmm. Does everyone start by themselves or do you get assigned a partner? How does it work?
So when you, in any law enforcement agency, when you come out of the academy, you go through what's called a field training period. So it can last, 3 months, 6 months, whatever. So you're assigned with a training officer.
Okay.
And then you just progress through different phases. And then eventually, you get off of your FTO, they call it, field training officer period, and you're on your own, and you get to drive the car, you get the...
So were you excited, nervous?
What oh, absolutely. I mean, just to get off of FTO is a big deal because that's a, there are some people that don't make it through that FTO period. You can actually get let go or terminated for not...
Okay. At what point is your job protected, like...
Well, then once you get on off of probation.
Okay.
And that's a year. It's a year of probation. But the FTO period is the first 5-6 months of your career. Sometimes they extend it if you're not progressing like they could, like want you to. And it could be for a lot of things. I mean, it could be for report writing. It could be for officer safety stuff. It could be because you're not learning the geography, whatever. Mm-hmm. There's just a different things that they're looking for. But so... Thankfully, I had some really good senior field training officers, and they weren't like some of them can be really hard on you and put pressure on you. These guys were senior officers, very knowledgeable. I learned a lot from them. Talked about, the first thing was just being safe.
And this is in
alive.
San Diego at that time?
I was in Orange County.
Orange County.
Time. Yeah, I was working in Orange County in Santa Ana and then South Orange County in
What were the predominant freeways that you were running? Was it the 405?
405, the 5, the 22, the 57, the 55.
Okay.
I could go on forever with
it. It's a lot of freeways.
Do you remember that Johnny Carson bit? You guys are probably too young to know about Johnny Carson. He would have a bit where he'd say, you go north on the 405, and then you get on the 110, and then you go on
No, I don't remember the bit, but I remember that experience.
Oh, yeah.
Because, I'm growing up in the Central Valley, right? Jim, I don't know if you remember this when you started to go to the bigger cities, but Central Valley, back in the day, you took the 99. 99 would take you north and south.
That's it, man.
And then I went to the Bay Area, and there was like 7 freeway changes, the 101, the 280. So
you were going to ask me a question about...
Oh, okay. So here's the deal. Okay, so you're finally on your own.
Yes.
And from the story that, you know, I'll let you finish the story, but yeah. It begins with you're doing a routine pullover.
Yes.
And this driver just keeps going.
Yeah.
Take it from there.
This is what's funny about it, because I only recently told my sister this story.
And here it is.
And I don't know why it came back to me when I told her. But anyway, so I'm on patrol. It's within my first year of working on the highway patrol. I had been off of field training period, so they trusted me enough to give me the keys and go out and do my thing, and trusted me that I wasn't going to get hurt myself or somebody else. So, and it's always a big thing. I mean, part of the CHP training is the emergency vehicle operations course. I mean, that's a big deal. We drive a lot, obviously. We're in the car a lot. We're driving at high speeds, enforcement driving, they call it. It's not your normal driving.
Well, okay, so here's the thing about it that I noticed even back in the day. Jim, have you ever looked at the dash of a highway patrol vehicle?
Yeah, they're crazy. It's like
Compare it to regular vehicles at the time. We had the light switch up and down, the radio, and the AC. And I looked at yours, CHP, and I remember this is like 90s maybe. There was a screen and a keyboard.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm like, how are these guys managing all of this and knowing what's what?
Hey, back in the day when I started in 1980, it wasn't like that. We didn't have those onboard computers until later on. But, yeah, there are a lot of, there's a lot of gear there. You got to be able to operate your equipment, your siren, talk on the radio. You got to get the handset off.
But then everything you're wearing, too, your tactical gear, the stuff that you're wearing, your vest, all that stuff.
Your gun belt.
Mm-hmm.
You got to be seat belted in. It's not a comfortable environment sometimes, especially working in the valley when it's 100 and some degrees.
Yeah.
But to get back to your story, before we get off track, I want to clarify.
So it's a routine pullover.
So, right? And
what did you see that made you pull this person over to begin with?
Well, one of the things that's a big deal for any CHP officer, any officer, is your first pursuit. When's it going to happen? How are you going to do? Are you going to do the right thing? Are you going to catch the guy? Are they going to get away? Yeah. Are you going to get in a crash? A lot of questions about being in a pursuit. It's kind of like a rite of passage for an officer.
It happens to everybody at some
and
point.
And eventually,
right?
you get it happens. But so here I was, I'd been on for not quite a while, but some time, and I'd made a lot of stops by then. And I start pulling this guy over, a Hispanic guy, as I recall. And I think it was for registration. It was a simple violation, a registration violation. And we were actually on surface streets. We weren't on the freeway. It was an area, an unincorporated area. And so I put my red light on him, and we're going. It wasn't really high speed. I would say maybe 40 miles an hour. I'm following him. He's making a couple turns here and there. I don't even remember how long it was. But at some point I thought, is this guy running from me? Am I in my first pursuit? And I was reluctant because I didn't want to call it out on the radio and have everybody start, high speed over there. And then the guy pulls over. It's no big deal. Well, it was a pursuit later on because the guy ended up crashing. He ended up taking a turn too fast, and he ended up crashing into a brick wall or something.
And you never called it in.
I at the very end, just before that happened, I called it in. And then he took off running, and we caught him, and he was drunk driver and all this kind of stuff. But it was just that thought of, like, am I in a pursuit?
Is this it? This is what it feels like?
Because you won't believe this, but, or maybe you will, you wouldn't understand how many times you put the red light on someone, and they don't see you behind them. And you follow them for a long time.
Okay, so that happens,
so
too.
So that happens.
But it's a different maneuvering happening, right? It looks
exactly.
It looks like real, you can tell.
This guy was, he made a couple of turns, and
yeah.
But it wasn't real high speed. But then again, I remember following an older woman. There was a place down in Orange County called Leisure World, where it was a retirement community. And
Leisure World. That sounds
Leisure good. World, yeah. They're all over the country. And I think they still exist.
Sounds like an RV park.
So I stopped this lady, older lady. I see her out on the on the road, and she's got the gray hair, and she starts driving that way, so I know that's where she's living.
Yeah.
She doesn't see me. And this these communities, they have gates to get in there with guards at the gate. She drives right past the guard, and I'm still with my light on. I've got my siren on, and he's trying to wave her down. And she finally pulls into her little garage, and I'm back there. She goes, "Oh, what are you doing?" So,
did she get a ticket?
I don't remember, to be honest. One of the things about me, I hated writing tickets.
Okay, so here's the question.
That was not my favorite thing to do. I was like, "Okay, you're right. Go ahead, get out of here."
We gotta get pulled over by. So, Jim, I know you've heard this one too, right? And we even talk about this in the car. It's like, okay, guys, be careful because CHP has a quota that they have to meet. So if this is the end
question.
If this is the end of the month, you do not want to draw on any attention. Is this true or is this a...
So, first of all, I will say that there is a statute in the vehicle code. It is against the law for any agency to establish a quota for tickets.
There you go.
There is
false,
a law.
Jim.
So, but
yes,
now,
yes, applause for that.
No quota. They cannot say you have to write this many tickets. It's in the law.
Yeah.
And rightfully so. Okay. You don't, that the purpose of writing citations is to make things more safe. It's not to generate revenue. It's not for anything like that.
Yeah.
So, but
devil's
with
advocate.
That in mind,
devil's advocate.
With that in mind. If I'm a CHP officer out there for 8 hours a day, and that's my job is to watch people's driving habits, if I can't see someone speeding or running a stop sign or red light, then I must be driving with my eyes closed. So then your supervisor, your sergeant, you know, come in at the end of the day or at the end of the month, and he's like, "What have you been doing all this time?" You know,
so play the opposite role of that. Imagine is it your captain or your chief who's in charge of you?
Well, it depends. I mean, the sergeant's usually
sergeant.
The guy.
Okay, so
frontline.
So imagine you got a guy named Robert Escarrota comes on the force and he has no tickets for 2 months.
Does he get jumped in the locker room?
You're probably going to have some remedial training, and you're probably going to be made to ride with a senior officer and see how they do it.
Yeah.
Stuff like that, because it really is. I mean, face it, that's part of the job is to do that, but you do it for the proper reason is to change people's driving habits and bring attention to it. But nevertheless, I just didn't quite like doing that. My thing was, you know, the thing that I really tried to focus on was drunk drivers.
Oh, yeah.
I made a lot of arrests.
That's 100% unsafe.
And I worked a lot of times at night rather than day shift or swing shift. I worked at night and made a lot of arrests for drunk driving.
Wow.
Yeah.
Now, without getting into too much detail, because we try to stay as family oriented as possible, there's a lot that happens in cars.
Yeah.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
What is the most comical or unusual activity? Because I know some people drive with their knees, right? You seen that one, Jim? People driving with their knees. Not me.
But. I do it. My legs are long. So
God. Here he is on camera. Yeah. That's Jim said that.
Yeah.
Not Rob. What was the most unusual?
I told you one of the things was that lady putting her makeup on, but
yeah,
any number of things. I mean, what you're trying to allude to, I won't say it because it's a family oriented show, but I've seen those kinds of things happen.
Is that a ticket?
Oh,
or is that guys?
There's not a.
Can you guys move on?
I would say that would fall under the unsafe speed law.
Oh, okay.
You really shouldn't be driving when that's happening. I think that would be an unsafe speed.
Oh man,
there's a catch-all section.
And how do you address that? Like, hey guys,
it's 22.350 of the vehicle code. I still remember that unsafe speed. Essentially, you shouldn't be driving. Depend on whatever the conditions are on the road.
You're visually
your
impaired.
You can get in trouble for going too slow.
Right? Yeah, exactly.
Oh, and you know what? My wife does that a lot. She's like, "You're going to get a ticket because you're driving too slow. How slow do I have to drive before I'm just like going to get pulled over?"
You know what? You got to be impeding traffic. I think it's about 10 miles an hour slower than the rest of the traffic.
Yeah.
Especially if you're on the freeway in the fast lanes or the left-hand lanes. But yeah, it's about 10 miles an hour. There's not really any set number. It just depends on what's happening behind you. But I've stopped people for impeding traffic. You know, some people get up in age. Some people just aren't comfortable driving, and they get on the freeway and they're doing 45 miles an hour.
Yeah.
That's one of the things that used to irritate me.
Go ahead.
I'm going to tell you a good story, though.
Yeah.
Okay, you talked about some funny things. Just popped into my mind. You know what? It's funny. All these memories start coming back People start talking to me about it. I recall there was a car stopped on the side of the San Diego freeway. And I can't remember what happened. They were there for some reason. They were looking at the map or whatever. So I pulled in behind them. And I talked to them, but they weren't from this country. I think they were from China or somewhere like that. So I couldn't communicate very well with them.
Didn't have the Google Translate.
Have that. And so I was trying to get my point across to them. Hey, what's going on? Okay. And then apparently they thought that they were supposed to stay there. So I left. I cleared the stop, and I went driving, you know, and I came back around another hour or two or whatever, and they're still sitting there.
Waiting to see what's going to happen.
I guess for me to tell them to leave or something. I'm like, you can go now. You can go.
Did they take off the second time?
The second time. They finally left, but they actually thought, like, I guess I'm supposed to stay here.
He's coming back for us.
It's such a fun job. Now that you make me think about all these things, I mean, I love going to work. I never, ever, there was never a day, and I can honestly say this to people, there was never a day that I regretted or didn't want to go to work. Because I knew there was going to be something different, you know. Even if I had a report holding over from the day before that I had to finish, but I knew I was going to encounter something or see something.
Yeah.
At some point, it became more about helping people. I realized, you know, first it was excitement when you're young. You know, that's what was the draw, the excitement, the variety. But then at some point, I realized this is about helping people. It might be the worst day of their life.
Yeah.
Most people don't encounter a CHP officer in their lifetime, you know, and so your presence there and how your demeanor and how you treat them could, you know, shape their opinion of law enforcement in general the rest of their life.
Now that you say that, Ray, I'm going to share something with you, and I don't even think I've ever told Jim. So I got in a car accident when I was 7, right? And I was asleep in the back seat, and car didn't stop crossing over. We hit the car. We spin out. I'm the first one to wake up, right? Everyone else knocked out. Oh. I wake up my cousin. We crawl out of the car because the doors are jammed, right? Bloody scene. There's a guy on the road, right, from the other car, flew out of the vehicle. And I remember my relatives were right behind us, so they pulled out, and then it was a CHP. And the CHP guys saw that we were kids, right? And so they were, like, trying to, like, make us feel, like, at ease. And that went a long way with me. And I was like, man. So then fast forward to about 25 years old now. And we're in San Luis Obispo. Mm-hmm. And I think this is, like, the nightclub scenes. Mm-hmm. Jim, do you remember this place called Tortilla Flats in San Luis Obispo?
I remember that.
You know Tortilla Flats?
Yes.
So I'm at Tortilla Flats, and I'm with my friend, our mutual friend Nasser, and another friend, Frankie. And Nasser and Frankie happened to be inside the club at the time. And for whatever reason, I went out to the car, or I was out by the parking lot. And, you know, you hear the familiar sounds of an accident, right? Mm-hmm. Loud crash. And this accident happened, I want to say, like, on Monterey or Higuera Street. It was within a block, and I could see the collision happen. And my instinct was to run over there. And I remember running over there, and obviously the first couple of seconds, there's no one on the scene. It's just the accident just happened. Police aren't even informed yet. And I remember the driver had, there was impact enough where the seatbelt, I mean, the steering wheel had kind of come in on her, mm-hmm. and it was kind of, she was pinned in. And she's starting to freak out because she can't exit the vehicle. And she's got the broken glass on her, a couple of minor cuts, but I couldn't tell unless it was eternal. There was nothing physically, but emotionally you could see her eyes were wide, and she started to panic because she couldn't get out of the car. And so I stood by the window, which no longer exists. The window's all broken. And I'm talking to her, and I'm saying, hey, listen, the cops are on their way. You're going to be fine. I need you to breathe, because she's starting to, right? And so we start breathing together. I'm taking deep breath, and she's following me, and we're just keeping her light. I said, you're going to be okay. You're going to be fine. She's like, okay. And then the police officers arrive, CHP, and they do the jaws of life or whatever to get her out. So what I appreciated walking away from that was this idea that you have to be first on the scene for many of these cases. And, you know, if someone's deceased, well, that's also pretty tragic. But a lot of times they're either injured or trapped. And you're the first face they're seeing. Can you recall a time when you had to keep somebody at ease? And
I'll tell you one that stands out in my mind. There were many, I will tell you that. I mean, the one that stands out in my mind, working here in Fresno back in the late 80s, and this was a time when Fresno was always in the news for being the top, one of the top cities for vehicle thefts. Us and Trenton, New Jersey.
I remember, was it the Hondas?
The Hondas, the Olds Cutlasses, the Chevy pickups. Those were like easy, the top pickings, ones that were
screwdriver.
Getting stolen. They're really easy to get into. Wow. They pop them with the screwdriver, and then they jam the steering column and the ignition, and off they'd go.
Wow.
And so, I mean, Fresno, the CHP keeps track of pursuits. It's not just something that happens and you have fun and dust everybody off and you go. It's a lot of reporting. You have to write a pursuit report. Were you within policy, et cetera? So Fresno was just popping off back then with pursuits because of these vehicle thefts that were happening. And at the time, the city of Fresno, the police department, had a no pursuit policy. They were not allowed to pursue cars unless it was a extreme felony murder.
So then you just take off.
Something like that. So
what was the mindset behind?
Safety.
Oh, okay.
Just safety. I mean, they, you know, pursuits are dangerous.
Because they're going to go fast. You're going to go fast.
They're inherently dangerous. And this is where I encountered the situation. So the pursuits were popping off back then. There's every week you'd get in a pursuit almost. And the Fresno area, we topped the whole state for pursuits for years in a row. So I stop a kid. You guys know where Valley Medical Center is? Do you remember where that was?
Yeah, back in the day? Kings Canyon.
Kings Canyon.
Near Fresno Fair.
Kings Canyon and Cedar.
I was born there.
Were you? Yeah. So that was a big trauma center. So we would, all the really seriously injured accident people would be there. Or people that we arrested that needed a blood test, we'd have to take them there. So we were leaving that place, me and my partner, and we see a car go by, and it's kind of bumping, you know, just messing around with the traffic in front of it.
Yeah.
And it looked like a juvenile, and I'm thinking, it's probably a stolen car. We stopped at Cedar and Belmont, I believe it was, put the light on them. They take off immediately. I mean, moving. So we put the lights on and siren. We start chasing them. Well, they come up to Olive Avenue, and it's a blind intersection because of the buildings. And there's a car going westbound on Olive. And the kid, that it was a teenager, the kid that we were chasing ran the red light and hit these people broadside.
Oh.
Head on. I mean, right at the driver's door. And they were construction workers coming home. This was late at night. And so I run to that car, the victim's vehicle. And sure enough, the driver was just on his last breath. I mean, he was still alive. And there was no obvious blood, but he was breathing really labored. So I remember just thinking, okay, I got to keep him breathing. I got to keep his head still because he didn't want to hurt. I didn't want his neck to be injured. So I got in the seat behind him and just held his neck there just steady and talked to him for a while. And then the paramedic showed up and everything. They took over. But I think that gentleman ended up dying later on. And then there was a passenger in the car that lived, but he was hurt pretty bad. So that one was the one that stands out in my mind. I didn't have to do CPR or anything like that, but I just remember sitting there and trying to comfort him.
Being a calming presence.
I knew he was still conscious or alive because I could hear him breathing. But you just do what you got to do. I mean, try
help
to make
people. So let me ask you about this, and Jim, feel free to chime in. As teachers, sometimes we have incidents at school that carry over at home. You know, you try to leave it at school, but sometimes just like, wow. And having kids that are school, high school age, you know, I'm sure Jim does this. I know I do. It's like, man, I wonder what that would be like if that were my child, you know?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So do you ever have incidents that you see out on the road that just kind of stick with you at home, or are you really good about leaving work at work?
Yeah, you know, you have to really be able to compartmentalize, because you see a lot of things that most people won't see. And if you bring it home with you, it'll tear you up. It'll cause emotional.
Is there counseling that they offer for CHP?
Absolutely. And they have counseling if you need it for free. You know, they have numbers you can call if you need help.
Is there any standard protocol for like, okay, so-and-so saw a 15-person fatality accident. They got a report.
They will usually go through what's called a critical incident debriefing.
Oh, okay.
And that's standard, and depending on what the situation is. But if you see a big fatality, or you see, let's say you see a young little kid got run over and killed, you know, that's obviously traumatic. So they would, you know, ask you if you wanted to attend a critical incident debriefing. And they have trained psychologists that come in that work with law enforcement and know how to deal with those kinds of things and that sort of thing. So, yeah, they try to help you as much as you can. But as far as bringing it home, it's interesting that you say that, because when my kids got to be driving age, you know, and I was still working patrol, and I'd see things, and it really made an impact, because you'd think that could be my child.
Yeah.
And I actually know an officer who responded to a fatal accident where his child was involved.
Oh,
can you imagine that?
And his child had passed.
Yes. Yeah.
So okay. So here, let's do this now.
You bring it home. Yeah, and you know, you try to instill. I would talk to him about things. You know,
what would the CHP officer tell his child in today's driving climate?
What I've always told my children: first of all, don't drink and drive. That's the big thing. Okay,
that's huge.
Impaired driving is the leading cause of accidents or fatalities, and
or even, you know, smoke, being high,
right? Being high, marijuana, smoking, being any kind of impaired driving. When your mind's not completely focused and be able to pay the attention that you need to driving, you shouldn't be behind the wheel. So that's the first thing.
Yeah.
Secondly, wear your seatbelts. Seatbelts save lives. I've seen it hundreds of times in my own experience. You don't go flying around out of a car, you got a good chance of surviving.
Yeah. And I'm sure you've seen where there's an accident where someone had the belt and another didn't. And the one with the belt is still in the car.
Yes, yes. I got a good story on that one too, if you want. But
wear your seatbelts.
Wear your seatbelts. Don't goof around, you know, don't be playing. Driving is a serious business.
Yeah.
You know. That's why they don't let, you know, when you first get your driver's license, you can't have kids in the car with you until you reach a certain age of driving. Did you know that?
No.
Yeah, they restrict you. When you first get your license, you can't just have kids your own age in there. You have to have an adult with you if you're going to have younger kids in the car with you.
Is that permit or actual driver's license?
The driver's license.
Oh, I didn't know.
And that is because of the tendency for kids to goof around in a car.
Get distracted.
They're playing with the radio. They're laughing and joking. I mean, that's, you know, you're a kid.
Yeah.
So that kind of thing. And then the other thing is just driving at a safe speed. My kids are trained. There's this thing that they teach you when you're at the CHP Academy. It's called maintaining a high visual horizon when you're driving. So it means exactly what it says. The further away you can see things, you train your attention as far out ahead of you as you can, because the more time you have to react to something, the better off you're going to be, because you're not going to have to make a swerve, you know, a last-minute swerve, a hard break, or something like that. And the other thing is the people behind you probably aren't doing that. So especially when you're on the freeway, give yourself a lot of space.
Do you hear that, viewers?
No tailgating. That's probably the worst thing tailgating. You can do. Give yourself a lot of space around you. So those are kind of the things.
I'm going to replay this part for the kids at home.
Those are the main things, but a high visual horizon.
High visual horizon.
Train yourself. If when you drive home today,
yeah,
think about where are you focusing your eyes when you're driving? Is it just on the car in front of you, or is it the car four or five cars ahead of that one? Because your peripheral will help you see what's right in front of you, the immediate.
Yeah.
But way out ahead. That way you have plenty of time to react.
Pile-ups, right?
Pile-ups. I mean, anything like that.
You're going to say something, Jim?
Do you have kids that drive?
They're about to.
Right? Yeah.
So they're right about to.
So my daughter has been driving now about a year. She's mm-hmm. just turned 18.
Mm-hmm.
And I used to ride motorcycles. So, well, when I had them, I still have my license, but I don't have one. But
that makes me nervous.
I used to always drive defensively. Mm-hmm. And so my trick yep. was telling her was imagine everyone is going and wants to hit you.
Yep.
And drive defensively. You have the ball. Everyone wants to hit you and tackle you. And so when you're seeing other cars four or five cars further away, it does. It helps her, and it keeps her where she's going. I'm assuming she's listening to me mm-hmm. And stuff. We just got her a new car, but the distractive driving is a scare for me big time because they want mm-hmm. their cell phone hooked up to their speakers or their radio, their phone, all that stuff to be able to communicate. And I said, I told my wife, I said, I wish we bought her a car that had none of that, you know, because that's the scary part. But my dad used to drive fast and not realize that the brake lights are a half a mile down the road, that the freeway is slowing down.
Mm-hmm.
And he would hit the brakes at the last minute. And I used to hate it all the time. And my mom's like, he's not looking ahead. And it always scared me when we were driving because my dad would just floor it. And
he'd be nervous the whole time.
A lead foot, right? They would drive fast and then hit the brakes harder, you know, fast and then harder. So I have one question, and I know I could say it because we're on a public venue here. But what really chaps my behind,
hide.
Right,
my
is the
my
way hide. The world is changing to where the disrespect at a level. And you made a comment earlier to where, you know, someone's pulling you over, the makeup lady. It's like all they had to do was just remind themselves of being disciplined.
Yeah.
And really, that's kind of a backbone to what you guys are doing is you're disciplining mm-hmm. something that is either illegal, right? It's legal or illegal.
Yeah.
But when they get so mad and they fight it and they get so angry at you or any officer, and my dad used to always tell me, do what you're told. Do what you're told. And then if you have a case, if they're disrespecting you, and I know these bad cops out there have kind of put a tainted mm-hmm. image on a lot of what you guys do, but what really upsets me is the fact that just do what you're supposed to do. Fight the legalities later.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you are like, I'm reaching in the glove box, and then it's like, well, you know, all these things that I've seen, it really makes me irritated that they try to fight it, that they have more rights than the person who's disciplining them and
right.
stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
And I just wish they would just realize you have a job. That's what you're supposed to be doing. You saw something that was wrong. And you're just telling them about it.
Mm-hmm.
I appreciate all the cops that have pulled me over in my past
mm-hmm.
by just reminding me, hey, you're speeding. Hey, you're doing this. Hey, you're doing that. And let me go because later on, I got two tickets in one weekend.
Oh.
Driving to Pismo and then coming home from Pismo. And my insurance messed me up. And it's later on that I realized, what was I doing? Why was I in such a hurry, especially coming home? I was trying to get to...
Speeding tickets, yeah, both of them?
Two of them. Friday night, Sunday afternoon.
Oh,
yep, coming home. And I'll never forget that. And it made my insurance go up. It made me pissed at myself, you know, and all this stuff that I was just like, I was just, hey. And there was no warning. I was, you know, it's like, well, it was my fault, you know. But anyways, that I just wish people would realize you guys are doing your job. Do what they're supposed to be doing
mm-hmm.
and don't... push it, ask for your badge. I mean, if they want to ask, that's fine. All these legal things, that's there. But there are just so many videos out trying to explain to people how they could get away
yep.
with the wrongdoing that they just did.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it's just whatever. So
that doesn't make sense. It doesn't help anything when you're trying to get away with doing something wrong. You know, one of the things that I enjoyed, I actually kind of like to brag about it. In 30 years on the Highway Patrol, I never had a complaint against me. Never.
Wow.
And the reason being, because I think, was because I never took it personal. It's not that people weren't upset with me and, like you said, arguing with me about this or that, But I never really took it personal. They didn't know me, and I know they didn't know me, but it was the badge, it was the uniform, it was my authority that they were upset with.
Yeah.
As long as I kept that mindset, I was able to, hey, okay, say whatever you want.
Shake it off.
I stopped an old man one time, an old man, he's probably younger than I am now, and he had his grandson with him in the car. And I was going to write him a speeding ticket, so he comes out of the car. You know, I'm standing by my door writing my ticket, and he comes out there, and he just called me every name in the book. I'm not kidding you. I mean, every single bad word you could think of, he said it to me.
Wow.
And I knew he wasn't going to hurt me. He wasn't a physical threat. So I just sat there and let him vent, and then I said, are you done now? And he's like, okay. So I said, what would you do? How would you feel? You got your grandson in the car with you. What do you think about him hearing how you just talked to me? You know, how does that make you feel? Would you say that? Would you speak to that him in or to me in front of him that way? And the guy was like, and it just I knew I got him. He was like, oh man, you're right.
But I'm shocked. Wow. I'm shocked you didn't say anything about him getting out of his vehicle, because that's technically a threat, right? It could be.
It and that's part of being an experienced officer.
Sure. Okay.
Reading people. Mm-hmm. You know, why start a fight over that? It's unnecessary. Mm-hmm. But, and that's one of the things that gets me now about sometimes I see these police officers, they kind of get a little heavy-handed. And there's a lot of ways you can avoid those kinds of confrontations mm-hmm. when you don't throw fire on it. And that's one of them. I mean, yeah, you don't want them out on the side of the freeway because it's dangerous. Yeah. But it's not illegal, but I can certainly say, hey, look, you need to get in the car because it's dangerous out here. And it's all about how you approach it, how you respond to it. But don't escalate things. You de-escalate things.
One of the other stories I want to finish off with my part is I worked with Justice Jones up in Sierra Unified up there. But, what's his name?
That was the name of the police officer?
Yeah,
Justice. Jones. His name was Justice.
Yeah, nice name.
A great name.
Javi Rubacaba. And then there was Officer Greg Martinez, who was they do PIO here in Fresno, mm-hmm. but McKinley, my daughter, put together the E15 program at Liberty High School. Were you ever part of any of those?
No.
Mm-mm. So it's the simulated drunk driving. Where
every
the kids,
15 minutes.
Yeah, every 15.
Oh,
minutes.
Every 15 minutes. I know that one. Yeah.
So she put that on as a junior, and it just such a huge impact on herself and. Mm-hmm. She was so proud of the fact that she, as long as she knew that someone who saw that saved one person's life, mm-hmm, you know, she felt like it was worth it. Yep. But it was one of those things where the kids have to see it. I don't know if Robert, your high school do it?
Yes.
Yeah, so it's a huge impact. And so I was really proud of the fact that she did that. But she had to work with all the officers, mm-hmm. the fire department, the paramedics and the whole thing. And so if anyone is listening, ask your local high school kids if they are experiencing that, because I think it's a huge impact when they see their own friends passed out or dead on the road. And
really
stuff.
Emotional.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Huge, huge. So
it grabs them. But that just goes to what I think, you know, the Highway Patrol stands for, law enforcement in general. We're out there to prevent things. We're not out there to catch you doing the wrong thing.
Yeah.
Like I said, I hated writing tickets, but it was a necessary evil. But it was about preventing things from happening. You're trying to stop it before it happens. If
being
you can
proactive.
Save a life, like what you were saying, these every 15-minute program. And, you know, you don't know how many people it saves, but I know that someone's life is impacted. And
absolutely.
Somehow, you know, it's going to work out for them for the better, you know, because of that program. But that was, you know, that's the other thing about the Highway Patrol that I really like, was helping people.
So I wanted to ask you about this, because I know there's a helping side, which you're part of that, obviously, with no complaints in 30 years. That's crazy. In the 90s, you were an officer, mm-hmm. still, and we had the L.A. riots and the Rodney King incident.
Mm-hmm.
Now, was that CHP involved, or that was LAPD?
The actual riot, or
the Rodney King incident.
So it started with a CHP officer.
Okay,
they were making a stop on the 210 freeway. Rodney King was speeding, and they got into pursuit. They knew they were in a pursuit. Unlike me, they knew that they were in a pursuit.
They called in help,
and they called in help, and so LAPD arrived because it was in, you know, that jurisdiction, and they came in as a backup and that's where that all happened.
So then that escalates. And so I always wondered, like, during that time, was the CHP, like, were you guys called into meetings and say, hey, listen, guys, we got this incident happening? I mean, what kind of feedback do you guys get when these things happen?
Big. There was big changes in our culture. The thing that really came out of that I recall that policies changed was that officers were essentially mandated to stop excessive force if they saw it happening.
Oh, I see.
They actually said, you know, if you see something happening and you think it's excessive force, it's incumbent upon you to step in and say, hey, stop it. That was one of the big things that came out of that for us.
Yeah.
There were definitely some policy changes because of that. And then, you know, here's the thing. That's not the first time that ever happened to somebody. I'll just tell you that right now. My own experience being in LA area, seeing, you know, things in law enforcement.
Yeah.
The thing about that was it was caught on video.
That was
video changed everything for law enforcement.
So that was, yeah,
if
okay.
You notice.
Yeah.
Video. The
body cams.
Ability to have your phone and flip it out and start video recording a police officer. Body cameras. The cars and the videos on the cars now.
Yeah.
That changed law enforcement forever. Because up until before that, let's say that incident with Rodney King had not been videotaped.
Yeah.
What do you think would have happened with it? Probably nothing.
Yeah.
He probably would have complained. He might have, but who would have believed him, right?
Yeah.
They would have done an investigation, and maybe they would have found that these guys did, you know, do something, but never to the extent, I doubt very seriously, any of them would have been gone to trial on it.
Yeah.
So that, essentially now you have videotape that, unfortunately, sometimes you catch officers doing things that they shouldn't be doing.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, 99% of the time, the videotapes are going to vindicate the officer. And you know, you mentioned that I'm a private investigator now.
Yes.
So one of the things that I do probably primarily is I work with law enforcement agency and I do internal affairs investigations. So they bring me an external investigator. So I go in and investigate excessive force, other types of misconduct.
Yeah.
And a lot of the times there's video, body-worn camera video. And most of the time it vindicates the officer. It helps them.
So it does
helps
help.
My case.
Oh, good.
Absolutely. And yeah. Officers are getting more and more used to it now.
Yeah.
Because when it first came out, nobody wanted those.
Yeah.
No officer. Who would want, you know, basically your sergeant looking over your shoulder every day,
yeah.
Every minute of the day.
Can
right?
you imagine teachers with body
no
cams?
Exactly. No one's perfect. And here's the thing.
Yeah,
sometimes,
you can have bad days.
I don't think I teach.
You know, let's face it. Sometimes, you know, you're in a situation goofing around and someone might say something off-colored or something, you know, make a comment about whatever, use a bad language in a joking way.
Yeah.
You know, it's just the way officers, you know, it's gallows humor type stuff. And no one, those body-worn cameras are not for that. You know, that's sometimes they incidentally pick that up. And, you know, I had an investigation that I did for an agency up north, and that's what happened. One of the officer that was being complained against, he was talking to his partner away from the complainant, but he said a bad word about the guy. But he didn't say it to him.
Yeah.
And that was part of the complaint. But you know what? It was in the privacy of his own home, so to speak, I guess. But body-worn camera changed everything. Video changed everything in law enforcement.
Wow.
I tell people that all the time. It'll never be the same.
So you had were you around for the body cams?
I never had to wear a body
okay.
cam. I retired in 2010, and the Highway Patrol had just started getting cameras in the vehicles, you know, the ones that just point forward and capture, you know, the officer driving, but
yeah.
I never had to wear a body-worn camera. No.
Okay. Yeah, because like you said, someone's watching you the whole time. So let's now you're, yeah.
not,
nobody's
perfect.
TV.
Let's put a BWC on you while you're at school for a day.
I think the part that's toughest for teachers is, you know, sometimes we're having a tough day, and obviously, you know, you want to be appropriate in front of the kids, but you sometimes at your desk, you say some things to yourself, just to recenter that maybe shouldn't, you know, be out there.
Yeah.
Right. Lord, give me strength.
I know.
But I think real TV, when that came out, with my background, it became
reality television.
Reality television. It became became more of an entertainment type of thing, to where and it was, there were pros and cons on both sides, because it protected you guys. It let everyone see, like, holy cow. But I remember covering stories in Fresno where, you know, if there was a police chase or something, we were all over it. We were chasing it just as much as you guys were. And
on the scanner?
Yeah, on the scanners and stuff. We had 5 or 6 scanners at the desk. But the interesting part was, when I was interning down in L.A., they never covered chases. A lot of the stations that I was working under, they didn't cover it, because it was a daily routine. It was Now, if it turned into a really bad chase, it was on. But there was chases every day on the freeways. So they didn't cover it.
Yeah.
They didn't cover it. So same with shootings.
Yeah.
Shootings too. They stopped doing it. So, but yeah.
So in the line of duty, would you ever have any close calls where you're like, wow, this could have been my last day?
I recall one towards the end of my career. Actually, I almost got run over.
Oh man, I see those videos.
I almost got run over. I did see my life flash before my eyes. When I was working up north in Mendocino County.
Is that just people losing control of their...
My last duty station, I was the area commander in Ukiah, Mendocino County.
Okay.
And if you've ever been up there, it's really green.
Yes.
It rains a lot, and there's a lot of trees, a lot of redwood trees.
Yes.
And so we were having one of these typical winter storms where the trees were falling over and roads were blocked, and so... I put my gear on, I put my rain suit on, and I went out and patrolled. You know, we just didn't have enough bodies out there. So I went out, and I came up on a tree across the road on Highway 128. It goes from Cloverdale out towards Fort Bragg. And I'm sitting there, I call it in for Caltrans to come in, and it's on a curve. And sure enough, I mean, that's one of the things they teach you in the Highway Patrol, is when you're on the side of the road, you're in danger. People don't realize that normally. So you just get used to looking back at traffic constantly. About every 10 seconds, you'll turn around. You're always aware of what's happening behind you. So I happen to look back, and here comes a guy in a truck, and he sees me. He sees my lights, and hits his brakes. Worst thing you can do, because that just causes you to start spinning out. And so he spins.
So where was he? You were on the side of the road.
I was in the road.
Oh, you were in the road.
I was in the lane. I wasn't even trying to move. I was just blocking so that someone else didn't come up.
Oh, okay.
And so I was in the road, but I was standing outside by my car. And I see this car coming up, and he hits his brakes, and he starts doing 180s like this, or 360s, boom, boom, boom.
Oh.
And he's coming. I'm not kidding. I don't know how he missed me. I had nowhere to go, man. I wanted to jump over the top of that car or something, but somehow, by the grace of God, he missed me. And that was, my heart was like, deek, 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 deek. And I was near the end of my career within months, and I thought, I probably shouldn't be out here anymore. But anyway, so I never had anybody pull a gun on me. I never had to shoot anybody. You know, there were some times when we had to use force, whatever, you know, wrestling around with guys. Maybe the baton or mace or something like that, but not very often. I think I was pretty good at talking my way out of those kinds of things.
Yeah, no, that's what you were saying.
It's not like escalating it.
Don't add to the fire.
Yes, exactly.
That's a great approach, I think.
I was a little guy. I didn't want to fight.
You want to get tussled.
I tried to talk my way out of those.
Now, being a private investigator, right? I imagine a lot of it is just reading body language.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure you're pretty good now at knowing when somebody's lying.
Yep.
Right?
Credibility assessments.
Even, like, I'll give you an example, because I know a couple of law enforcement officers who've been doing it a long time. Even the way you look at people, you know, you can tell that you're going through a process.
Mm-hmm.
You're not just reading. You're not just listening to what they're saying. You're looking at the body language.
Mm-hmm.
You're looking for any facial expressions, and it's really impressive.
Yeah.
But I've even tested officers, like, you know, I have a couple of friends who are like, hey, I'm going to tell you 3 things. All right. One of them's not true. And then I'll tell them, right? And I think I'm using the same face with all three. And they're like, you lied on the second one. How did you know? Well, you tend to one eye twitches all these little things. So as an investigator, I'm assuming like you just have body language down.
Well, there's a lot of factors that go into it because some people are good liars. and they can get away with it because
they believe it themselves.
They're just so good at it. They're used to it. But there's a lot of factors that go into it. It's not just one thing. It's the context. It's the consistency. Does it, what they're saying even make sense to you?
Yeah.
Based upon what you know about the situation already? Do they have a motivation to fabricate something? You know?
Don't you feel like you earned a sixth sense at some point?
Yeah, absolutely. And then there's
just a feeling. Is that all it is?
They stutter, you know, when you ask a question. If it's the truth, it's easy to talk about.
Yeah.
Right. But if it's not the truth, they got to start thinking about it and they'll stutter, you know. I guess you can tell when people are. I think I'm pretty good at reading people's body language and things like that. And
have you ever had a situation where you pulled someone over? And immediately, without seeing them or anything, you say, I got a feeling on this.
And
you happen to be right.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean,
that's just, what is that? Just an energy, or what do you think that is?
It's an energy. It's just experience from comparing other things that you've seen and done and what they've
felt
learned
like at them
along the way and
that's
how they're behaving, how they're moving. Are they aggressive towards you? Are they, you know, pleasant? You can tell. I mean, that's one thing you can tell right away when people are.
I remember who it was, but a police officer told me this once, Jim. He's like, you always know when they're going to run.
Are they a threat? Yeah. Their eyes start like darting this
guy's
looking around.
He's about to run.
Yeah, they're like, you're talking to him. They're like, the eyes start darting back and forth. Which way am I going?
And I saw one video, right? This is funny. The guy just barely got out of the car, and the cop's talking to him for like 2 minutes. And then in the middle of the conversation, the cop says, don't do it. He's like, what? I said, don't do it. I know what you're, look, just relax. Do not, what are you talking? Sure enough, he takes off running. And the cop said it like 5 minutes before he did it. He already saw.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
Circumstances, who they are. But the one thing I know, I recall is, the eyes start darting back and forth, like looking for an escape
route. like a
caged animal. I mean, think about it. It's a fight or flight thing, right? That's what you're seeing.
Well, here's the fight or flight. Jim, I don't know if you recall this. We have a friend from back in the day. Rest in peace. He passed. But it was a secondhand story. He's driving. And he's angry because he just got into an argument with his significant other. And, you know, that you want to get out of there as soon as you can. Well, he's impaired, right? He's been drinking. And he's not swerving or anything, but he's definitely not going to pass a test. The CHP pulls him over, and that sobers him like, oh, it's lights. He pulls over into an orchard. I don't know if you remember this. And just sprints into the orchard, he's gone, right? And it was just because he knew he was not going to pass the test. Runs, you know, maybe an hour in the orchard, just lose himself. Finally finds his way back to a phone or something and reports his car stolen. And I was thinking, how often does this happen?
A lot.
Right? I was going to ask you.
A lot.
He's like, sir, you said you lost your vehicle.
Yeah.
How did you get all the way out here, sir?
Yep.
So is that a common move to call yourself in?
Very.
Just
very.
Can you believe
confident hit and run. Oh, someone stole my car.
And it's all total. It's like, sir, you look like you've been in an accident. No.
Nine times out of the ten, it's not a stolen
They're
car.
They're calling themselves in.
Yeah.
Trying to get away with it. Wow. That's crazy.
Part of the job. Part of the job. Reading people. Hearing the stories that happened, you know, it always amazed me the things that people do when it's just you and them on the side of the road. The dishonesty, unfortunately, you know, it's like I always thought, man, I wonder what you would do if your child or somebody was here listening to this, what would you
totally
do?
Totally different.
How would you be, you know, exactly? Would you be prone to be dishonest? I mean, let's face it. Saving your skin is a very strong desire in a human.
Oh,
right?
Yeah.
Saving your own skin.
So here's the other one that Jim, I don't know if you saw this one or if your parents ever pulled this, but I had a friend whose mom was always getting tickets, right? And her husband gets so upset, she'd get in trouble at home for it, right? And he was always speeding. So she knew how to start crying at the drop of a hat. And she, did you know anybody like this? It was a friend's mom, and she was like, she got pulled over, and we had just been talking about Disneylanders. I mean, she was here, right, smiling, and the world was fine. She, yeah, you know, next time we'll take you guys with us to Disneyland. Police officer. As soon as he rolls the window down, she just conjured up. This was like 2-30 seconds. Like, yeah, guys, give me a second here. And the waterworks, and I'm like, what just happened? And, you know, does it work? Does that work?
Not necessarily, especially when you know it's not genuine.
So you can read crocodile tears.
Yes, yeah. Most of the time that doesn't work very well.
So when your sister Peony told me that you were doing private investigator work, immediately I'm thinking Magnum PI. I'm thinking,
everybody does.
Yeah, chasing cars down or a stakeout. Does that actually happen in your line of work?
I don't really do too much of that kind of work, to be honest with you. I mean, there's a lot of it out there if you want to be that kind of private investigator.
So that is a popular.
Absolutely, yeah. There's a lot of surveillance work that's out there, but it's not for me. I can't stay awake late at night anymore, especially just sitting there watching somebody and nothing's happening. So
now, what are the legalities? Like, let's say, for example, right, and somebody's infatuated with someone else, right? Uh-huh. And so they fabricate a story and say, I need you to keep watch on this person.
Uh-huh.
And you're now assisting a stalker, sort of.
Yeah.
What are the legalities?
Well, the legalities are, as a private investigator, you can't invade someone's privacy. You can't do anything illegal. I'm just like any other person now. I'm not a law enforcement officer anymore, so I have no right to do anything other than what you would be able to do.
Park on the street.
And, you know, as long as I'm in a public place where if I'm legally where I am and I can see whatever I'm looking at without, you know, a periscope or anything like that it's perfectly legal. But you're right. Sometimes that does happen where you get a client and they want you to do something and it's not necessarily for the right reason. So that's up to you. You got to be able to, you know, use your moral compass, your judgment, and say, look, I don't really want to do this because I don't think it's for the right reason. But then again, there are times when someone is suspecting their spouse to be, you know, cheating on them or something like that, and they need to know that or they want to know that. Well, that's okay, too.
As long as I deliver that news.
As long as I'm not, you know, peeking in windows or getting onto their, you know, their property or anything like that, it's perfectly legal in California. It's if you're in a public place. And that's kind of what the whole, to become a private investigator in California, you have to take an exam. You have to have a certain number of hours of investigative experience just to qualify to take the exam.
Yeah.
But then the exam itself is not like anything I would have expected. It's all about just keeping yourself out of trouble and basically instilling upon you that you're a private citizen now. You're not a police officer. You can't, you know, just go onto people's property like you used to without, you know, being allowed there without permission. Attorney-client privilege is a big thing because you work with a lot of attorneys. Invasion of privacy.
So a lot of the tests is watch your butt.
That's what it is, how to stay out of trouble. Wow. And remind you, yeah, it was an interesting exam.
Wow. Okay, so here's the last thing I wanted to go over because this part was surprising to me. I don't know if I missed it but I found out that you were the mayor of Lemoore, the town that you grew up in and that you were raised.
Mm-hmm.
What was that like? Like, what does that entail? Is that like a full-time paid position? Is that a volunteer situation? How does that work?
I looked at it, and in most small towns, it's not a paid position. It's a voluntary position. You are an elected official. You have to go through the election process.
Okay.
You have to be elected. You can't just become the mayor. But it's community service. So I was on the city council for 4 years.
Yes.
And then the term of mayor was 2 years.
Okay.
So the way they do it in that city, in Lemoore, is the other council members appoint someone to be the mayor.
Oh, there's no
general
there's
election. No election. But some towns you do elect a mayor. But
were you surprised, or they come to you and tell you, hey, we're thinking about you?
You know, it's kind of like a rotation almost sometimes. Oh, okay. But then again, it just depends on the makeup of the council and who they feel like can be, you know. Essentially what you do as the mayor is you make sure the meetings run legally and well, you know, you keep them in order, you follow the agenda, make sure that people are allowed to come up and do their public speaking if they want to, you know, when they open it up to the public. Basically just that. And then there, you know, you go to different meetings and gatherings and represent the city of Lemoore or whatever. But it was fun. I really enjoyed it. It was community service.
What year were you there?
Yeah, man, I think it was 2014 to 2018.
Okay, yeah, it was when I arrived.
Yeah, I think that's when my 4-year term was. But it's community service. I tell people that all the time. It's because I wanted to help my community.
Yeah.
And, you know, some people, that was about the time I moved back to Lemoore from when I was living up north. And there was things going on in the city council that some people didn't like. There was a lot of drama going on.
I remember Lemoore being in the news.
Yeah,
the
so they asked, you know, some people said, you ought to run for it. And honestly, I look back at my career with the Highway Patrol, and that really helped me in that role, because as I moved up in rank and progressed in the organization, I got to be exposed with other community leaders, you know, supervisors, city council members, all those kinds of things. And it helped me learn how that process worked. But actually being on the city council as an elected official is, I learned so much. I really enjoyed the experience. Mm-hmm. One of the things that you have to understand that I knew just instinctively, I guess, is you're not running the city. Even as the mayor, you don't run the city. You hire the city manager. That's the only person that the city council is responsible to bring on. They're the only ones that they can hire and fire is the city manager and the city attorney. And then you bring him on as the CEO of the company, essentially, and he does all the day-to-day work. He's the one that oversees all the department heads, all that kind of
stuff. That's the paid position.
And all you do is you're basically policy, you know, what policies you want to adopt, what direction you want the city to go to, whether it be, you know, growth as far as bringing in housing, businesses, that kind of thing, making it business friendly, trying to create policies that help businesses succeed. It's not about running the city. And unfortunately, especially in smaller towns, it becomes that, unfortunately, because people come and they complain to you about things and they expect you to do something about it. So, you know, I would, obviously that's part of it. They're your constituents. So I would hear them out and say, okay, let me get you to the right person in the city.
And they're like, it's not me.
Let me get you to the building department.
That's the misconception.
And I would facilitate meetings for people, you know, like, well, I've been there. So I would just facilitate meetings and just try to, but it wasn't my decision or wasn't my choice to do certain things. I didn't control the outcome.
I'm glad you said that, because I've realized now that being a nonprofit, there are some times when people come to you and you aren't even empowered to create that solution.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to be really good about communicating that. Mm-hmm. Say, hey, listen, I'm hearing you.
Yep.
And if there isn't anything happening, I promise it's not because I ignored your issue. It's just I happen to have a limited amount of power in that particular area.
A lot of times it's people, they don't even know where to go. That's the they don't know where to start. It's a bureaucracy. And they're kind of embarrassed or shy or whatever. They're reluctant to go start asking questions, so they know you.
They start with you.
They start with you, and then I would just show them the way.
We have stray dogs. Where's Mayor Ray?
Stray cats. Ooh, that was a big one. Let me tell you, the stray cat was a big deal.
And, you know, sometimes it's funny. It's like, we don't always know. Well, let's do a test real quick. Jim.
Feral cats.
Jim, who's the mayor of Madera Ranchos?
I know what he looks like.
Do you know his name?
No, he's a Well, no, I do.
Yeah, the mayorship sometimes kind of just...
I think it... Well, it rotates. So it rotates often out
Who's
here.
Who's the guy right now?
Vince.
We're bringing him on RobLive.
Vince something. He does our propane. He's a he owns our propane.
Vince is the mayor.
Yeah.
Mayor Vince,
yeah.
Please let your constituents know your last name, because apparently...
I'm not positive, but I think it's a matter of fundraising. They do something out here that they... or they had one kid that was... He'd always walk up and down Avenue 12.
Mm. Yeah.
And everyone loved him. He waved to everybody and stuff. And they nominated him to be our mayor. Qualified or not, don't know. I think he just was a lovable guy, you know.
Yeah.
So, it's just it's an honor type of thing, but I don't know what
honor
really
symbolic,
yeah,
that
yeah.
kind of thing.
Okay, see, I didn't know. I thought it was like getting in the, you know, nitty gritty.
Oh
of
no, you're
changing
not,
policy.
You're not changing. You know, I don't think you do much.
You're just one of five people. You're one vote.
Oh, okay.
You're one vote out of five people. Your vote as the mayor counts no more than any of the other council members.
Okay.
And.
I had that all wrong.
But you know, one of the things that I would encourage people, and hopefully if they listen to this, go to the council meetings. Educate yourself. They're open to the public. Everything that the council does is by law has to be done in public.
Do people show up?
A few, not as many as you would hope. There's usually a core group of people that are there all the time.
Yeah.
Maybe 10, 15 people that show up at all the meetings.
And you know them.
And you know them.
Hey, Susie, back again, huh?
It's because, you know, Tuesday night, their favorite show's not on TV that night. So they'd rather go down to the city council meeting or something.
That's entertaining.
But exactly. But I really encourage people to become involved in it and go down there and listen. Look at the agendas. It's all on the websites, wherever you live.
Yeah.
It has to be by law. They have to announce everything. There's only a few times where we would meet in what's called closed session, where something, you know, legality, maybe there's a lawsuit against the city or something. It still hasn't been decided. So the attorney would give us a briefing or ask us, like, what do you guys want us to do on this or something like that. But everything else has to, we can't make any decisions behind closed doors. It has to all be done out in public. They have to see
transparency.
Who you vote. Who's voting for what? You call for the roll and let the chips fall where they may. But that's one of the things that I wish people would take more time to be involved in their own communities, because that's where there's a saying, all politics is local. Have you ever heard of that?
Yeah.
All politics is local.
Yeah.
And it really is. I mean, yeah, sure, the president is an important person, the vice president, the senators, everything, but the ones that really impact you day to day are your local city council and county supervisors.
That's a great way to say that.
They're the ones that are going to make sure your water's running. They're the ones that are going to make sure your trash is picked up. They're the ones that are going to make sure that there's police and your community safe, where you can walk to the park and the park's in good shape.
Yeah.
Those are the immediate impacts that anyone sees every day you walk out your front door. So that's where it really has to happen.
Well, thank you for being here. I want to kind of summarize some of the things that Ray shared with us today. Number one, politics is local, so get involved in your local politics because it does directly affect you, viewers, wherever you may live in the United States or around the world watching us today. He also shared, as a California Highway Patrol officer of 30 years with zero complaints, he talked about the value of relationships with people and trying to de-escalate situations.
Yep. Yes.
By communicating well, right? Mm-hmm. Wear your seatbelt. Do not drive distracted. And contrary to Jim's belief, if the light inside the car is on, you will not get a ticket.
We need to look that up.
We do.
We're going to look that up.
But, we really do.
Yes. Well, thank you for being here, Ray. We really appreciate you being on the show. You had a lot of great insight for us, and I leave inspired.
Thank you. It's a lot of fun. I'm glad that we finally got to get together.
Yeah.
We've been talking about it for a while.
We have.
I really like what you guys are doing here. This is a great studio. You guys got a great place.
Yeah, that's all Jim. That's all
neat.
Jim.
There you go.
And I wanted to, one last lesson to you viewers. If you ever break your ankle, I don't care what happens, you show up to the dance.
You got to.
You hear me?
Even if you got to dance one-legged.
You show up at the dance. Life's about the boogie. All right, guys, until next time, this is Jim Chance with Chances Are Productions and Rob Live. We are saying love, peace, and chicken grease. We're out.
Good one.